Okay, so let's come to the more difficult story, and more interesting one, and the one that I was involved with for many years, that is the story of quantum mechanics. Now, let me start by saying, why is quantum mechanics called quantum mechanics? Well, it was discovered at the beginning by Planck that if you take any form of energy, you know that energy can flow by electromagnetic waves, for example, that you see all around you. They are a form of energy and momentum that moves around with the velocity of light. Any kind of wave, water wave, sound wave, any kind of wave is made out of lumps of energy, small lumps of energy that cannot be divided anymore. And those lumps of energy are called quantum. Quantum is a word that says that something cannot be divided further. The quantums of electromagnetic waves, especially kind of electric magnetic wave with light wave, are called photons. So photons are little lumps of energy, very small, that cannot be divided further. So if you look at light, you see that it's completely continuous. But if you take light and shine it through a very little hole, so that very little part of it goes through the hole, and you put a photographic plate behind it, you don't see the photographic plate becoming dark continuously. What you see instead is every time one point appears at one place, one point appears at another place. These points are points where each individual photon hits the photographic plate. And only when you have many, many photons, the thing becomes back like a continuous thing, exactly the same as water wave looks to you continuous, but in fact, if you look with a big enough microscope, you see that the water is made out of atoms. So, or you look at the sand near the sea, and you see that the sand is made out of grains. So these grains of energy, or lumps of energy, were the beginning of quantum mechanics. And they are extremely important to understand what is the most fundamental, strange aspect of quantum mechanics. It's an unbelievable thing that nobody could have guessed it, and even today it's very difficult to accept it. And the idea is the following. If you start with two particles that are exactly the same in the beginning, no difference between them, and they are acted upon with the same forces, so there should not be any difference in their future, and nevertheless there is one. One particle may decide later, decide in quotation marks, may move later to one direction, and the other particle, for no reason at all, moves in a different direction. How is it possible? How could nature behave in such unbelievable way, such capricious way? Really unbelievable. You have two atoms. The atoms are excited, and one of them shine lights after 1 minute, and the other shine lights, you know, when atoms change their energy, a photon comes out. That's the origin of all light that we see. So one atom will decay, send the light, the pulse of light, after 1 minute, and the other atom exactly the same, for no reason at all, send that pulse of light after an hour. You have a picture about that, don't you? Oh, it's there. Okay. All right, so how on earth can we understand it? So first of all, I want to show you the connection between that and the fact that light is made out of these lumps of energy. Suppose I want to look at the position of a particle. I want to find where it is. And that particle is a very small particle, like an electron. So I put that electron, I know that it is on this surface of the table, say. In fact, it's a surface of glass that you put in a microscope, very, very strong microscope. You look at the particle in the microscope to see where it is. Now, what must you do in order to see it? If it was completely dark, you would not be able to see it. So what do you have to see to do in order to see it? You have to shine light on it, right? And the light comes and scatters from the particle through the microscope to your eye. Now, if this was a classical light that behaves continuously, I could diminish it, make its intensity so low that it would not disturb the particle at all. And I would still be able to see where it is. But if light is the way that nature reveals about light, that it must be made of this quantum of energy, this lambda of energy, at least one of these photons, which is this lambda of energy, must hit the electron and come to our eye. Now, although the energy of this photon is very, very small, the mass of the electron is so small that being hit by this photon, it gets a jolt, a real kick. And in fact, you can show that the more, the better you want to find the position of this particle, the penalty that you pay, that you introduce a bigger uncertainty in the velocity. You don't know which direction it's moving after that. So Heisenberg, who was one of the fathers of quantum mechanics, developed a thing that is very famous now, that is called the uncertainty principle. And the uncertainty principle says that the more you know about the position of a particle, the less you can know about its velocity. And the uncertainty principle, I will write a formula, but don't be alarmed, it's a very simple formula. The uncertainty in the position, the uncertainty means how much uncertainty of the position means that the uncertainty is this, this is the mean that the particle will be somewhere here and we don't know exactly where it is. So this is number that tells you how uncertain the position. You multiply it by the uncertainty in the velocity, and that must be larger or equal to a universal constant that in the honor of Planck is called Planck constant, and it's a very, very small number. I will not bother you with the exact value of this number, divided by the mass of the particle. Now, it turns out that if the mass of the particle is the mass of an electron, it's about the same value of this number, so the ratio between them is equal to 1, and that means that if you try to localize the electron inside the region of an atom, which is the relevant thing, the uncertainty velocity becomes huge. So, for electrons, this uncertainty is very relevant. On the other hand, for us, for the things that we see in everyday life, if you put the mass here to be, say, 1 gram, then the change in the velocity will be so minute that you will have to wait more than the age of the universe before you can see any difference. That means that's the reason why in everyday life we have never suspected that you have this uncertainty, because it has to do, it is relevant only for very, very small particles. Now, that behavior, that strange behavior of nature that says that you can't predict the future, this theory, the nature is non-deterministic, let me say exactly what it means. In classical physics, if you know everything about a classical particle, you know its position, you know its velocity, then you can predict exactly what will happen to the particle later. No uncertainty at all. That means that classical physics was deterministic. The present determined the future. This is called the deterministic theory. And that looks like a very natural thing. How on earth could it be different? If we know exactly everything about the particle, the future should be completely known. Now comes quantum mechanics and say, no, that's not true. In fact, you can never know enough about the particle to predict its future. It's not only that you don't know, the future is really not known. The only thing you can talk about are probabilities. If you have the particle, you know as much as you can about the particle at one time, you can only predict the probabilities of what will happen to it in the future and not the future exactly.